Hello friends, up till now we have seen level measurement. We have seen different types of the level measurement system. In today's lecture, we are going to see load cell and the DP cell. What is load cell? First of all, we should know what is load cell. Load cell, it is a type of resistive type of transducer which is used for the measurement of the level. So specifically, load cell is nothing but we can say it is a transducer. Now, as we are focusing on the topic level measurement, so these load cell type of transducers, how it can be used for the level measurement. So we should know what do you mean by load cell and what is the working principle of the load cell. So as I told you, load cells are nothing but the transducers. That means it can convert one form of energy into the another form. So we can say specifically these are the force type of transducers. So these load cells are typically the force type of the transducers. Now it converts force such as tension, compression, pressure or any torque into the electrical signal. Why it is called as force type of transducers? Because it can be able to convert compression, pressure or torque into the electrical signal. And that can be measured and that can be standardized. So that's why it is called as load cell or the force transducers. So as the force is applied to the load cell, it increases the electrical signal and change it proportionally. So let us see working principle of the load cell. So what we have seen, that load cell, it is a sensor or a transducer that converts a load or force acting on into electrical signal. So these electronic signals can be a voltage change, it can be a current change or it can be a frequency change depending upon the type of load cell and the circuitry used. So that means the force or the pressure or the torque is converted into the electrical quantity, which can be a voltage, current or the frequency. So depending upon that, it is having two types. So what are the types of the load cell? First type we have to focus on, that is a resistive load cell. Now what do you mean by resistive load cell? So resistive load cell are primarily depending upon the piezo resistivity principle. Now we have known that what is piezoelectric principle. Now we have known what is piezoelectric principle. What is piezoelectric principle? In the piezoelectric principle, first of all, we are using the crystal-like substance. So what is this crystal-like substance? This can be quartz. So this quartz crystal is responsible for converting the electrical vibrations or the mechanical vibrations into the electrical signal. And what is the converse part of this piezoelectric principle? That whenever the electrical signal is applied, it converts that electrical signal into the mechanical vibrations. So this resistive load cell works on the principle of the piezo resistivity. Now what is this piezo resistivity principle? That when a load force or a stress, we have seen in the piezoelectric principle that whenever the mechanical force is applied, it is converted into the electrical signal. That means when the load force or stress is applied to the sensor, it changes its resistance. Now in this, that force is proportional to the change in the resistance. So in this piezo resistivity principle, what is happening? The force which is applied, it is proportional to the change in the resistance. So this change in the resistance leads to the change in the output voltage when the input voltage is applied. So this is called as piezoresistivity principle, which is depending upon the piezoelectric principle, that whenever the force or stress or the vibrations are applied to the sensor, it changes that force into the proportional electrical signal, and that change in the resistance leads to the change in the output voltage. So this is about the resistive load cell. Then the next load cell, it is the capacitive load cell. Okay, so what we have seen in the resistive load cell, that the force is proportional to the change in the resistance. In capacitive load cell, it works on the principle of the change in capacitance, which is ability of system to hold a certain amount of charge when the applied voltage to it. Now, in this capacitive load cell, what is happening? There is a change in the capacitance when the voltage is applied to it. So, for common parallel plate capacitors, now this is the condition, that is, for common parallel plate capacitors, the capacitance is directly proportional to the amount of overlap of the plates and the dielectric between the plates, and it is inversely proportional to the gap between the plates. So, in these capacitive load cells, what is happening? Whenever the voltage is applied, that voltage is responsible for hold certain amount of charges within the capacitive plates of the capacitor, and that force is responsible, or that force is giving us the proportional output voltage. So, the capacitance is directly proportional to the amount of overlap of the plates and the dielectric between the plates, and it is inversely proportional to the gap between the plates. So, this is the capacitive type of load cell. So, we have seen resistive type of load cell and the capacitive type of load cell. So, let us see one by one. Let us see how does a resistive load cell work. First of all, we should concentrate on the diagram. So, this diagram shows us the resistive type of load cell. Now, what we can see, this is the internal structure of the load cell. This is the physical structure. In that, what we can see, there are strain gauges which are connected over here. Now, why we are using the strain gauges? Strain gauges we are using, so we can say these are the Wheatstone bridge. So, these strain gauges are responsible for change in resistance. So, what we have seen in the working principle of resistive load cell, that whatever the voltage is applied, that is giving us the change in resistance. So, to get the change in the resistance, we are using the strain gauges over here. And this is the applied force. When the force is applied over here, the load cell will be changing its resistance. Now, the question is, how this load cell is changing its shape? The answer is, it is the elastic type of load cell. Now, this is the elastic type of physical structure, so that it can deform. So, let us see. A load cell, it is made up of elastic member. So, elastic member means with a highly repeatable deflection pattern. It can deflect with the applied force. So, when the force is applied to the load cell, it is responsible, that force is responsible for deflecting the load cell, resistive load cell, to which the number of strain gauges are attached. So, I told you these strain gauges are responsible for giving in the change in resistances. So, in this particular load cell, which is showing in this diagram, what is there? There are total of 4 strain gauges that are bounded to the upper and the lower surfaces of the load cell. So, as you can see here, so these are 1, 2, 3, 4 strain gauges which are applied on the upper and the lower surfaces of the load cell. And these strain gauges are responsible for giving us the change in resistance. Now, let us see how does it work. So, what we have seen, when the force is applied, the deformation is taking place in the load cell. So, when the load is applied to the body of resistive cell as shown above, so we can see here, these are the arrows which are showing the applied force to the body. So, in this, the elastic member, because this is the elastic type of material, so the elastic member deflects. So, you can see there is a tension and this is compression. So, when the force is applied from the upward side, there is tension at the lower surface and the compression at the upper surface. So, why this tension and the compression is forming in this load cell? Because due to the elastic nature of the load cell. Now, it creates the strain at those locations due to the stress applied. Now, what is happening here? It creates the strain over here. So, what is the basic principle of these force transducers or the load cell, that the force is converted into the electrical signal. So this force can be a strain, pressure, or the compression. So here we are getting the compression and the tension by applying the force on the above surface of the load cell. So the elastic member deflects, as we can see here, it creates a strain at those locations due to the stress applied. So as the result of this, that is compression and the tension, the two strain gauges are compression. So the upper two strain gauges are in the compression, whereas the other two are in tension. So which other two are in tension? The lower surface strain gauges are in tension. So during this measurement or during this movement, the weight acts as a load cell's metal spring element and causes the elastic deformation. Now the question is, why it is called as load cell? Because the weight which is applied on the upper surface of this cell is acts as a load cell's metal spring and causes the elastic deformation. That is why it is called as load cell. Why? Because the force which is applied over here, it causes the compression and the tension in the elastic material of this body. So that is why it is called as load cell. So this is how the load cell is working. So how it is working? Due to force applied, the compression is taking place on the upper two surfaces where the two strain gauges are applied or these are connected, and at the lower places the tension is creating at the two strain gauges which are at the lower side. Now these strain gauges, that can be positive or negative, is converted into the electrical signal by strain gauge installed on the spring element. And the simplest type of load cell is the bending beam with the strain gauge. Now here, there are positive or the negative strain gauges and which are converted into the electrical signal. These strain gauges are responsible for giving us the change in resistances, and this change in resistance is proportional to the electrical signal. That can be voltage, current, or any kind of frequency. So for that purpose, what we need, the strain gauge should be installed on the spring element, and the simplest type of load cell is the bending beam with the strain gauges. Now this type of change in resistance can be calculated by Wheatstone bridge, and that Wheatstone bridge is nothing but, we can say, a strain gauge which gives us the change in resistance. So this is, we have seen about the resistive type of load cell. Then next is capacitive type of load cell. So in the capacitive type of load cell, it works on the change in the capacitance, which is the ability of system to hold on certain amount of charges when the voltage is applied to it, and capacitance is proportional to the amount of overlap plates and inversely proportional to the gap between plates. So this is the capacitive type of the load cell working. Now let us focus on the DP type of cell, or the differential pressure transmission. So first of all, we should know what is the DP cell. Then we will proceed forward for the differential pressure transmitters. So what is the DP cell? So DP cell works on the, or it works by the applying differential pressure. So in the DP means differential pressure. So this DP cell works by applying the differential pressure to the either side of metal diaphragm immersed in the non-conducting oil. And the movement of the diaphragm changes electrical capacitance, the ratio of change in potential difference of the cell, and in turn electrical output signal. So let us see what is differential pressure transmitter. So this differential pressure transmitter will sense the different pressure between two parts and produces the output signal with reference to the calibrated pressure range. So let us see the diagram of this. So in this diagram, this is for differential pressure transmission. So here what we can see, here we can see the differential pressure transmitter. Now this differential pressure transmitter is responsible for sensing the differential pressure. So this differential pressure can be sensed by this differential transmitter. So it consists of what? It consists of a liquid tank. Now how the differential pressure is applied? Differential pressure is applied either side of the metal diaphragm, which is immersed in this non-conducting oil. So this is non-conducting oil or non-conducting liquid, and the movement of diaphragm changes the electrical capacitance, the ratio of charge potential difference of the cell, and in turn electrical output signal is getting. So this is minimum level, this is maximum level. So in this, the metal diaphragm are acting as the capacitance plates, and in between that, the charge potential difference between the two plates we have to measure, and that is proportional to the applied voltage. Now in this, the measurement of level in the industrial application by differential pressure transmitter is frequent. So these differential pressure transmitters device is used to measure the level and inferential measurement in a DP transmitter, and the diaphragm senses the head pressure developed by the height of the material in the vessel. So this quantity is applied by density variable to get the correct level measurement. So how it is working? A great specificity of the differential pressure transmitter is that it is effortlessly fitted into the existing vessel. So it requires very less efforts to fit into the existing vessels. It can also be retrofitted to a working tank or the vessels. Maintenance of the DP transmitter is easy, as it can be isolated from the process by isolation valve. So we can see here the isolation valve. This is the isolation valve, and through this the pressure is vented to the atmosphere. So in that, what we have seen, that it can be isolated from the process by the isolation valve. It is ideal and may be only alternative for the total level measurement in the separator, because separate vessels undergoes a wide variation of composition in the process materials. So these DP transmitters are ideal for level measurements of the liquid. So what is the specific application of this DP transmitter? That it can be used, or these are ideal for the level measurements in the liquids, because what we have seen, in the non-conducting liquids we have to immerse the diaphragm plates, and that diaphragm plates are acting as the two plates of the capacitors, and in between that there is a dielectric medium is forming, and it holds the charges of the applied voltages. So it can also be used for the light slurries with the extended diaphragm, which fits flush to one side of the vessel. So this level measurement by DP transmitter is more cost effective than the other available sensors. So basically what we have seen here, some advantages and the limitations of the level measurement by the differential pressure transmitter. So what is the advantage we have seen? That the installation is very much easy, in that it can be retrofitted into the working tanks very easily. The maintenance of the DP transmitters are easy. Why it is easy? Because it can be isolated from the process by isolation valve. It is ideal and may be the only alternative for total level measurement in the separator vessel, because the separator vessel undergoes a wide variation of composition in the process material. Now in this, ideally this can be suited for the level measurements of the liquid. So which type of liquids? Non-conducting type of liquid, in which the extended diaphragm can be used, and these are most cost effective than the other available sensors. Now, a broad range of the accurate level can be measured by differential pressure transmitter, which subjects to the stability of fluid density. In case of unstable process fluid density, an extra DP transmitter is used to estimate the density. Now, since these DP transmitters are located away from the tank, for the measurement of level, cleaning maintenance of the tanks are easy, because the DP transmitters are having the far location from the tanks. The accumulation of the water at the bottom of the tank that can be ascertained by the differential pressure transmitters. So these are some advantages related to the differential pressure transmitters. Now, when the fluid density changes, what is happening? When the fluid density changes, the multivibrator transmitter can measure the tank level accurately. So it will deliver same accuracy in both open and the pressurized tank and the vessel. So this is the important advantage of this, that it will deliver same accuracy in both open and the pressurized tanks and the vessels. So this technology is responsible for the improvement of density compensation level transmitter. It is due to the hydrostatic measurement and the sophisticated multivariable sensing technology it is. These transmitters are used on board uninterrupted differential pressures. Now, in these, the temperature measurements to offset for the liquid and vapor density changes. Then the final data are transmitted in 4 to 20 milliampere protocol. A digital output signals are accurately proportional to the tank level. That means, first, the force is directly proportional to the change in voltage, and that change in voltage is again converted into the digital signal. And the digital signal is must be having the final data transmitted, which is having the value of current 4 to 20 milliampere protocol. So it's all about the load cell, capacitive cell and the resistive cell and the DP transmitters we have seen. Its applications we have seen. Thank you.